This is the story of Pan Am Flight 115. On the 3rd of February, 1959, a Pan Am 707 was flying from Paris to New York. The 707 was a state-of-the-art airliner that had just been introduced in the year before, and it was the best that aviation and Boeing had to offer in the late 1950s. But Flight 115 was not a non-stop flight. It had stops in London and Newfoundland, Canada. The plane departed London at 6:45 p.m., and the flight to Gander would take about 4 hours and 58 minutes. Once the plane left Shannon control, the plan was to climb and cruise at 31,000 feet. But there were thunderstorms in the area, so the pilots opted to cruise at 35,000 feet to stay away from the worst of the turbulence and the icing. This flight had two captains manning the controls: Captain Waldo Lynch, who was the pilot in command, and Captain Samuel Peters, who was acting first officer. At 9:50 p.m., Captain Lynch decided to leave the cockpit to attend to some business in the cabin. When he left the cockpit, the plane was stable. It was in smooth air cruising at Mach 0.82. The autopilot flew the plane while the other captain supervised. At about 10 p.m., the navigator asked Captain Peters to change the heading of the plane. They needed to turn to the left by about 20 degrees. Captain Peters turned the knob and observed what the plane was doing for a few seconds, just making sure that the plane was indeed doing what he expected it to do. When he was satisfied with what the autopilot was doing, he turned his attention to the "how goes it" curve, a graph that pilots plot to keep track of certain parameters like distance, cruising speed, fuel consumption, etc. It's basically a way to check if the actual real-life values of those parameters are where you expect them to be for the phase of flight that you are in. Otherwise, a graph to answer the question, "how goes it?" This graph was on his lap, and he had his head down doing the necessary calculations. As he had his head down, he was not observing the instruments. He felt the airplane buffet and then G-forces starting to build up on his body. As the buffeting increased, the instrument panel lights went out and were useless. He looked over to the left side, the other captain's artificial horizon. But it had tumbled, meaning that the plane's bank had exceeded the limits of the gyros of the artificial horizon. As Captain Peters looked out, he could see the stars. They were moving in a counterclockwise direction. This meant that the plane was in a nose-down right spiral and was about to roll over onto its back. He tried to grab the yoke and apply left rudder and ailerons to counteract the roll, but the sheer force of the maneuver kept him pinned in a seat. At this point, Captain Lynch entered the cockpit with considerable difficulty and somehow got himself back into a seat. He pulled back power on the engines, which were still at cruise power. The G-forces were so great that the captain couldn't even hold his head up. His feet were pinned to the floor. He glanced at the altimeter, which was spinning frantically. It read 17,000 feet. They only had 17,000 feet to save their jet. He shouted, "I have command," as he knew he didn't have much time to react. The stabilizer was in the full nose-down position, and the trim did not work. Things were not looking good for Flight 115. At this point, they were in a cloud, so the captain had no way of orienting himself. In the background, Navigator Lurd, who was seated behind the captain, somehow managed to tighten the captain's seatbelt around him. As he did this, the captain managed to level the wings, which reduced the G-forces that they were being subjected to. The flight engineer, who could now move, threw himself at the circuit breakers and started flipping switches. He pulled the circuit breakers for the stabilizer system, which deactivated it, and he started rolling the stabilizer wheel by hand into the up position. They were now at 8,000 feet and still descending. Captain Lynch started to pull back on the yoke. At about 6,000 feet, the aircraft buffeted as the 707 bottomed out of the dive and began climbing. At 9,000 feet, the captain asked Flight Engineer Sinsky to roll the stabilizers forward to see if the plane would respond, and it did. After they verified that the plane was controllable, they climbed back up to 31,000 feet. The plane then landed at Gander with no further issues. The 119 passengers on board were safe, but they were understandably shaken. The plane itself had suffered some structural damage, but it was repairable, and so was flown to Seattle to Boeing's facility. With the plane in their possession, the investigators decided to comb through the systems to see what could have caused a modern 707 jet to just tumble out of the sky, killing nearly 129 people. They noticed when Captain Lynch had entered the cockpit, the trim was in the nose-down configuration. They questioned Captain Peters, and he said that he had not touched the nose-down trim switch. He only used the autopilot disconnect switch that was near it. They also turned their attention to the PB-20D autopilot system that was installed on the 707. This system apparently had some issues of its own. This autopilot system would just disconnect for no apparent reason without a mechanical failure in the system. What's more puzzling is that the autopilot would work flawlessly when it was re-engaged. Was this plane subject to that flaw, you ask? Well, this particular 707's autopilot did disengage on the flight before the accident flight. What's even more bizarre is that the warning light never came on to warn the pilots about the disengaged autopilot. In fact, their first warning sign was seeing the artificial horizon showing the plane in a 20-degree right bank. That's like using flames as a warning light to see if your house is on fire. They checked the warning light after landing, and the bulb did not light. It wasn't broken per se. Some of the time it worked, and other times it didn't. It was intermittent. If the bulb failed on the night of the accident, it would have deprived the pilots of a very important warning that they could have used to avert the accident. But that's not the only explanation. The warning light had a dimmer cap on it, and at Gander, the warning light was found to be completely dimmed. With the autopilot now being the main suspect, they subjected it to extensive tests. As mentioned before, they found that in certain circumstances, the warning light would not light up when the autopilot disconnected. They also found minor electrical issues with the autopilot. Some contacts were misaligned, and the damage suggested that the parts had been dropped during manufacturing. The gyro also had minor issues, and a few other things. So the investigators think that the autopilot disengaged when the captain left the cockpit. But the issues that they had identified with the autopilot would not cause the autopilot to disengage in level flight. In short, the flaws that were found were not responsible for the autopilot disengaging. But they did notice that this autopilot system used two computers, and the outputs were compared to make sure that the output of the primary computer was correct. If these computers were to disagree due to a rogue or spurious signal in one of their outputs, that could cause the autopilot to fail. That's one theory. Or this failure could have been due to the co-pilot accidentally hitting the trim switches or the autopilot disconnect button. Actually, there was a system that would have saved them, the mach trim system. It applies nose-up inputs as the plane picks up speed, but it wasn't turned on by the crew. At first, they considered that the nose-down trim was a result of a malfunctioning mach trim system, but it wasn't. The investigators thought that the captain accidentally hit the trim switches in the heat of the moment, but Captain Peters was sure that he accidentally did not hit the trim switches. The Civil Aviation Board ultimately said that this accident came down to the inattentiveness of the crew of Flight 115. They said that the other pilots in the cockpit did not pay attention to the instruments and allowed the plane to get itself into an unsafe state. They also wanted pilots to be trained on the narrow margins of high-speed cruising. At those speeds, it doesn't take too much time to get yourself into a dangerous situation. Do you agree with the report, though? Like, yes, they should have paid more attention to the state of the airplane. Absolutely. But they weren't being unprofessional in the cockpit. They were attending to other things that were required for the safe operation of the aircraft. What's more weird is that the report completely acknowledged that the 707 autopilot had had issues in the past, and the autopilot of this very plane did have an issue on a previous flight before the accident flight. They also acknowledged that in their testing, the warning light failed to work in certain cases. But in the conclusions of this report, that's not brought up at all. They just said that the autopilot disengaged for reasons unknown. they didn't advocate for further study of the autopilot system in the conclusion of this report. That would have been good considering that these issues was not confined to this one 707. It's almost as if the Civil Aeronautics Board was like, yeah, autopilots fail. It is what it is. We're going to blame the pilots for this one. If you were around when this happened, do you know if there were any follow-up investigations into the root cause of the failures of the autopilot? Do let me know. I really feel like they left this investigation half done. What do you think? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you want to learn how a wrong picture crashed a plane, then I highly recommend that you watch my video on Loganair Flight 9466. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.